Hi everyone, Jessica here and welcome to CritIC. Elevated body temperature can have detrimental effects on the body, so it should be regarded as an alarm symptom for further investigation. This video covers a structural approach to hyperthermia. For simplicity, I'm excluding fever. Don't forget to check out my other video on hyperthermia, in which we cover the definition, why it's dangerous, and what you should do. Now, let's go. Hyperthermia can cause life-threatening multi-organ failure, so it's vital to try and figure out the cause. In this video, I'm providing you a structural overview that's helped me remember the causes of hyperthermia. As mentioned in my previous video, you could definitely make the argument that there shouldn't be a distinction between fever and hyperthermia, based on both pathophysiology as well as the fact that it's difficult to differentiate between the two in clinical practice. However, since I'm trying to convey an easy overview for you all, I've chosen to use the classical definitions of fever and hyperthermia, but you'll find overlap. Check out my One Critical Minute video for the definitions. Causes of hyperthermia can be subdivided into four main categories: drug-induced, environmental, endocrine, and neurogenic. Let's start backwards. Neurogenic causes of hyperthermia are due to damage to your hypothalamus, i.e. your thermostat. This can be seen in brain trauma, ischemic or hemorrhagic stroke, or an increase in intracranial pressure. Endocrine disorders that cause hyperthermia are rare, and they don't necessarily cause hyperthermia either. Examples are thyrotoxicosis, aka thyroid storm, pheochromocytoma, and Addison's. Other symptoms will help you in figuring out these diagnoses. Tachyarrhythmias like atrial fibrillation in thyroid storm, severe hypertension in pheochromocytoma attacks, and the triad of hypotension, hyponatremia, and hyperkalemia in Addison's, to name a few. Environmental hyperthermia can be split into exogenous warming, like in heat stroke when outside temperature is high, and endogenous warming, caused by extreme sports with inadequate cooling. Usually, it's a combination of both. For instance, running a marathon on a hot sunny day, or doing CrossFit in a gym with inadequate ventilation. Love CrossFit, by the way. Another important cause of endogenous warming is epilepsy. Drug-induced hyperthermia can be subdivided into three categories: drug hypersensitivity, altered thermoregulation, and idiosyncratic drug reactions. Let's focus on these a bit more. Drug-induced hyperthermia caused by a drug hypersensitivity reaction is actually considered fever, as it is an inflammatory response to a drug. Drug hypersensitivity reactions are classified by the Coombs and Gell allergy types 1 through 4. I plan on making a separate video on drug hypersensitivity, so we won't be going into this too deeply right now. For now, it's important to remember that it can occur with just about any drug, especially antibiotics. If a hypersensitivity reaction occurs, your main action is to discontinue the drug and provide supportive care. In rare cases, drug hypersensitivity causes multi-organ failure. Examples are type 4 reactions like TEN and DRESS, something for another video. The second category of drug-related hyperthermia are due to altered thermoregulation. Examples are anticholinergic agents, which disturb hypothalamic function, and sympathomimetics, which not only disturb hypothalamic function, but also cause secondary heat production due to increased muscle activity. The third category of drug-related hyperthermia are the idiosyncratic drug reactions. Idiosyncratic drug reactions are unpredictable, bizarre drug reactions that can occur irrespective of the given dose. Notable ones that cause hyperthermia are the neuroleptic malignant syndrome, the serotonin syndrome, and what we call malignant hyperthermia. Malignant hyperthermia occurs in response to general anesthesia in patients with a rare autosomal dominant gene defect. If you're in anesthesia, it's vital that you know about this syndrome. An interesting article is linked in the description. Serotonin syndrome is a group of symptoms including hyperthermia, agitation, and hyperreflexia, with varying severity but could be life-threatening. It is caused by serotonergic agents like SSRI antidepressants. Treatments consist of discontinuation of the drug and supportive measures. Symptoms may usually resolve within 24 hours. The serotonin antagonist cyproheptadine can be considered in severe cases. Neuroleptic malignant syndrome is a life-threatening condition associated with neuroleptics like haloperidol and risperidone, or the withdrawal of dopamine agents, i.e. anti-Parkinson agents. The pathophysiology is unknown, but probably has something to do with a blockage of dopamine. It develops in a few days after exposure. It is considered a medical emergency, and most patients require ICU admission. Stop the neuroleptic, start cooling and rehydration, and consider dantrolene or bromocriptine. Now, if you're attending a patient that presents with a toxidrome and he or she has hyperthermia, it's your job to differentiate between these causes. Take a look at this table and notice the similarities and differences. Vital signs won't help you. So how to go about distinguishing them? Of course, a decent history will help greatly. I then start out by checking muscle tone. If it's normal, it's either anticholinergic or sympathomimetic. Note that sometimes it's really hard to tell, especially if your patient is agitated. To distinguish between anticholinergic and sympathomimetic, check the skin and mucosa. Dry means anticholinergic. I have a few videos on these toxidromes in which we go through the assessment, complications, and treatment. Check them out. If there's increased muscle tone, check reflexes and mental status. Depressed means neuroleptic malignant syndrome, increased means serotonin syndrome. Go back to the patient's history and list of medication to see if the onset corresponds with when the medication was started or the dose was upped. In summary, when your patient presents with hyperthermia, beware of possible multi-organ failure. Go through your ABCs and start cooling. When figuring out the cause, get a history to figure out if it's drug-related, environmental, endocrine, or neurogenic. If it's drug-related, follow the mentioned steps to figure out the cause, discontinue the drug, and start appropriate treatment. Let me know what you think about this video. If you liked it, give it a thumbs up. Thanks.